Good evening, I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, Poppy Tooker, host of the weekly program Louisiana Eats on WWNO Radio. Hey, Miss Poppy.
Hey, Peggy.
Hello. He's back, Brian Morgan, who covers the classical music scene for us. Hello, Mr.
Nice
Brian.
To be back,
Hi.
Peggy.
And theater critic Alan Smason, also the editor of the online Crescent City Jewish News. Miss Poppy, so much news.
Oh,
restaurants
some,
and
no,
food?
Some big news, Peggy.
Oh, yes.
Because I understand that you have just been at a luncheon, and there you were presented the trailblazing chronicler of New Orleans history in journalism and communication, Donna Allen Roundtable Luncheon American Journalism Historians Association Award.
Well,
this is a big national award, Peg.
Well, thank you. I'm very honored, especially history and historians. That really touches my heart.
My
but thank
gosh.
You.
Very kind. Congratulations.
Thank you, and thank you to the organization.
As usual, I'm honored to sit next to you right here every week.
So I will hold it close to my heart.
Thanks for
yes,
having me.
Yes.
And so now we will talk about some food.
Okay.
How about that? There has been a spectacular new opening of an old restaurant that everybody knows, Broussard's Restaurant. You know, they described what they did as polishing a beautiful gem, and that is exactly what they did. It is gorgeous inside and out. It was more of a restoration than a renovation. Their new menu is exquisite, and I would really like to point
out,
oh my gosh, it's gorgeous. And of course, that beautiful courtyard that's so big and so gorgeous. And you know, they are doing a big return here. Now, there is a new dish, for instance, that's oysters Broussard, and it's part of the oysters menage a trois. This is continental food. It's really not, you know, your oysters Rockefeller from Antoine's. They're reaching back into New Orleans food history and bringing back elegant tableside presentation. We've got a picture of the veal, brie, and Gulf shrimp papillette with lionized potatoes, broccolini, and a spicy tomato coulis. Look at the exquisite preparation. Louisiana lump crab stuffed domestic lamb rack with blue cheese, roasted potato, Brussels sprouts, and bacon, and sauce bordelaise. And things you haven't seen. I don't know that in my lifetime I've seen oven-baked Dover sole served tableside with fingerling potatoes, celeriac mousseline, almond beurre noisette. This is stuff, and it's making my mouth water. Slow roasted half pheasant with a sauce perigodine. When was the last time you saw something like that? I mean, it really harkens back to the golden age of continental dining. And I am thrilled, and I just can't wait to dine there on a regular basis. And the bar is really fabulous too. Now, that we've talked about the pricey high end, I thought it would be refreshing to talk about lots of people's favorite words, free. So I think there's some places for some really good free and almost free eating in New Orleans. For instance, Mondays, red beans and rice, free in the bar at Toujac's at 6 o'clock.
Oh.
All you have to do is purchase a drink. And it is really a fun scene there in the bar. And you wouldn't believe you get a piece of cornbread. There's a piece of, look at the plate you get of red beans and rice for free.
And cornbread,
Now, if you don't get your red beans and rice on Mondays, you can go on Tuesdays to a really exquisite business over in the American Can Company. I have to say, if you didn't like to shop at the wine shop that was there previously, go back to that location because the Pearl Wine Company, those girls are doing some amazingly fabulous things. So there, you can get free red beans and rice on Tuesdays. Also, I really like this deal. On Mondays, you can go for Manny's and Martinis. For $20 from 5 until 9, you can get a manicure and drink a martini. If you're having a blue Monday, what a way to fix that up.
That works.
Then, this is also really, to me, big news. You know, Andrew Yeager's back in town.
Oh.
And he has a new business out in Bucktown, and it's called Bucktown Burger and Fish Company. It's on Old Hammond Highway. And on LSU game days, you will find Andrew himself at the front door making his grilled oysters, and they're $1 a piece. That's almost free. And so I'd say head out there. We'll cover more of their food later. But in the meantime, we have to give another nod to Dominique. I know, once again, people must think he's an investor. But Dominique is just so incredibly generous. And this Sunday, he's hosting an event for the 2nd District officer, who, of course, was tragically killed, Rodney Thomas. It's from noon until 6 out in front of Dominique's. Dominique is going to be in the Taco Loco truck. There's going to be beer from NOLA Brewing. There'll be New Orleans Police Department horses on display. You know, Dominique makes a signature cotton candy. He's going to be serving that. There's a silent auction. And all of these proceeds are going to benefit Officer Thomas's family.
Oh,
so good deed, Dominique. We couldn't help but bring him up again this week.
Most generous. Thank you, Poppy.
Thank you.
Glad we could share it. And now for something completely different. We're so excited because this October marks the 75th anniversary of an historic religious event in New Orleans that drew many thousands of the faithful, with events all over the city, as Andres Calandria explains.
Most New Orleanians recall the historic 1987 visit of Pope John Paul II to our city. But in October 1938, New Orleans hosted a religious event close to the size and scope of the papal visit, yet not nearly as well known, the 8th National Eucharistic Congress.
We reverence the Eucharist with much love and respect. So the Eucharistic Congress is inviting Catholics to come together to give reverence to Christ in the Eucharist, and then to have a procession and to literally bring Christ into the city and on the streets of the city.
Such religious gatherings have taken place nationally and internationally since the 1880s.
The National Eucharistic Congress was held October 17th through October 20th, 1938. The festivities and the events took place over 4 days. However, the preparation for the festivities and the events took over a year. So there was this whole year-long gearing up to the Eucharistic Congress.
Then New Orleans Archbishop Joseph Rummel was one of the key organizers of the event and represented the city in many aspects of the celebration. The specially designed emblem for the Congress combines religious symbols and a touch of Louisiana.
So the emblem is a circle, but it also has the cross in it. Down at the bottom, there is a crescent, and that symbolizes the Crescent City. Above that is a horn. Archbishop Rummel, in his coat of arms as the archdiocesan bishop, has a horn. And then above that is a chalice and the Holy Eucharist. Behind that is a pelican. And the pelican is significant both in the church and, of course, for the state of Louisiana. And then there's these rays of yellow and white, which symbolize not only the papacy, but the church. So you get Louisiana, you get the church, you get the papacy, you get this great piece of history, as well as the symbols of the city and the archbishop.
Reflecting the city's exuberance of the occasion, decorations were hung up all over town.
The large lampposts were decorated like palm trees. D.H. Holmes had banners of welcoming the Eucharistic Congress, of welcoming the pilgrims that had made the voyage here to attend the Congress.
Recently retired New Orleans Saints field announcer Jerry Romig remembers the conference well.
Banners everywhere. American flags, naturally, and then the banners of the Eucharistic Congress itself.
The procession down Canal Street was the last procession of the Eucharistic Congress. And there were 7 divisions of people that came down Canal Street. Those divisions were very large, and they were representative of the city of New Orleans. There was also bands that played. So it was almost like a small parade, 7 of them.
Participating in the Congress as a special guest was Cardinal and Archbishop of Chicago, George Mundelein. Mundelein served as a papal legate, a representative of Pope Pius XI for the event.
And it was his responsibility to be here to open the Congress. He took the train from Chicago. He was greeted with great fanfare. From then on, there was celebrations, there was mass, but there were lots of things going on in the city. The entire city was basically shut down, even civically, so that this was the event.
It was a time of great joy, certainly a time of humble pride for the people of New Orleans to be able to sponsor this.
The Congress was a great moment in the history of New Orleans.
Thanks to our producer, Kelsey Schreiber, and our editor, Larry Russeri, for their hard work on this feature. Next week in part two, we'll focus on the historic monstrance, a vestige of the celebration that will actually be on view next Friday at St. Mary's Chapel at the old Ursuline Convent as part of the preview gala for the exhibit, The Archbishop Wore Combat Boots, the Life and Ministry of Archbishop Philip M. Hannon. The exhibition and the monstrance will also be on view there and open to the public. The exhibit from October the 5th to May 26, 2014. Go to oldursulineconvent.org for more information. And we wanted to show you something that is, some New Orleans families have this, and I've actually purchased them online on occasion because obviously they're very much out of print. There was an actual book that was compiled on the Eustis Congress. We'll talk more about that next week. But sometimes you can find it online at A-Books.
Yeah, it's a magnificent book. I wish someone would reprint it.
It's beautifully done. And it was published at Madonna Manor in Hope Haven, where they actually had a printing press over there on the West Bank. So, thank you again. And we turn to Mr. Brian with some bad news.
I'm afraid so. I received word today that apparently this morning, Professor Philip Frohnmayer passed away after a very long struggle with cancer.
Loyola music professor, long time.
He was head of the voice department at Loyola since around I would say around 1982, 83. So he's been a fixture in the artistic community here for many years, he and his wife, now his widow. He was an excellent singer and has created so many great singers, I wouldn't even begin to try to list them. Brian Email would be the most conspicuous one at the moment. But it's a real loss for all of us who are alumni of Loyola, but also just in the whole arts community, it's a real loss. So we certainly send his widow and his daughter our sympathy.
And of course, Ellen, a longtime professor too.
Yes, and she remains on the faculty.
All right.
Thank a great you. Mentor, he really was.
Absolutely. Yes. And we look ahead to the New Orleans Opera Association's latest.
Yes, they're having a macabre note for October, which I'm certainly very happy about. Heinrich Marschner's Der Vampyr, The Vampire, which is certainly not in the top 40, so I'm very happy that the New Orleans Opera is doing it. Uh-huh. It was premiered in 1828 in Leipzig, and it has very much the flavor of Beethoven in his Fidelio, with it even presages Wagner to a degree, but for me it particularly reminds me of Beethoven, and it also presages Bram Stoker. So it's not the Dracula story. It's a it's about a British vampire and all of the women that he seduces and so forth. It's a very torrid plot, but really beautiful music, and it's being set in contemporary New Orleans.
Oh.
So it should really
very
be
Anne
interesting.
Rice, very
That's
Lestand.
Right. I think it's going to be very exciting. And the opera is also having a vampire soiree on the 5th, which you can contact the opera company if you're interested in the soiree. Mm-hmm. Soiree, but the opera is going to be October 11th and 13th. And I think it's really going to be really exciting. The opera, I wonder if it's ever been staged in the South, in fact.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's so great that Robert Lyle, and here we go, some cast members from the upcoming, Robert Lyle is open to innovation.
Yes, thank goodness. You know, for quite a while, we really were not open to innovation at the New Orleans Opera. Mm-hmm. So it's been a real adventure in the last several years to see what we can come up with over here.
Absolutely. And looking forward to that. One of the things, sort of as a backstory with the Opera Association, I am always so impressed by the organization, the ladies who get together, there's the opera luncheon and the Mad Hatters, but they're raising money throughout the year.
Absolutely.
There's a sort of a junior version of that. Also, there's the men's organization. There are just a lot of people who are very passionate about it.
Yes, and located at the beautiful Opera Guild home on Britannia Street.
Which they rent out for weddings, and
absolutely.
That's another...
Absolutely, and it's a magnificent place, source of income.
Source of income, too.
But, yeah, the volunteers are really terrific, and the board of directors works very hard for the New Orleans Opera. So even in this difficult economy, that in truth, in the news, we read about opera companies and symphony orchestras going under every other week, it seems like, and thank God that we're still doing well in New Orleans.
Another thing is they are entrepreneurial, and that my understanding is they have this magnificent, I think it's the Hawkins Studio, where a lot of the props are kept, and they rent out their props to other operas, and sets,
absolutely,
to other opera associations. So that's another way to generate.
Yeah, Maestro Lyle has really turned the company around. He's very adventurous. He's very organized and an excellent conductor as well. So I think our town is very fortunate to have him.
You are. Thank you so much, Brian. And turning to Alan so much, you have really been a man about town.
And I actually made it over to the World War II Museum, and I want everybody to come along with me. Time to dust off your patriotic pride and march over to the stage door canteen of the National World War II Museum, because they're going to have the Victory Bells presenting their latest offering, The Spirit of America. And this all-new show features tributes to the Andrews sisters, to the late Patty Andrews and Patty Page, both of whom we lost this year. And the three Victory Bells will rotate between four players. And there you see them from left, Kate Abreu, Mandy Ridgedale, Courtney Bowe, and Christina Perez. They're all fabulous singers and dancers. I must again give credit to Entertainment Director Victoria Reed for the outstanding job she does putting these shows together and the high production standards she has. The Victory Bells sing and dance right out of a dream. And that's a good thing, because Dream is just one of the 12 songs requested by audience members throughout the year, last year, and they show up as a tribute to the Great American Songbook. Some of the favorites that they have are from out of World War II, songs like Long Ago and Far Away and The Still of the Night, I Remember You, It's Been a Long, Long Time, As Time Goes By in Deep Purple. But there's also a tribute to American ballet, and what could be more spirited than a tribute to our national pastime as the Victory Bells take us out to the ball game. There's even some famous country swing music and a final homage to the armed forces. That's every Wednesday from now through November the 20th. It'll pick up again in January after a swinging Christmas at the Stage Door Canteen. As far as theater, let us move on to Mauritius. Mauritius is an actual tiny island that once was also the home to the dodo bird, which is, of course, extinct now.
And the hum of Dominique Marquet.
Okay.
And they used to make those plastic masks, you know, that look very anonymous, Mardi Gras,
In the world of stamp collecting, though, also known as philately, it is the source of two of the most coveted stamps ever produced, the so-called post office stamps issued in 1847, the first outside of Britain. They were a British Crown colony back then. A set of uncancelled post office stamps, 1 and 2 cent variety, is at the center of attention for the regional premiere of Mauritius, written by Teresa Rebeck. Rebeck is a veteran of TV shows like NYPD Blue and Law & Order Criminal Intent. She also was responsible for putting together Smash last year, if you remember. The script is very much like a female version of David Mamet, with the tough, gritty language of the street, and the intrigue over the stamps has five characters fighting it out to try to win the stamps for their own or make a fortune for themselves. The tale begins with the first of two half-sisters, Jackie, played by Leslie Bowles on the left, and Mary, played by Andrea Carlin. It's Jackie who is given the stamp album by her deceased mother now, even though Mary claims it was her grandfather who owned them originally. When Jackie takes the stamps to a local stamp shop for appraisal, she meets two seedy, distrustful fellows. First is Dennis, right here, played by T. Joe Siebert. He's a slimy opportunist who believes he stumbled onto the holy grail of stamp collecting. And the shop owner, Phil, played by James Wright, is a doubting Thomas who doesn't even bother to look at Jackie's find. But it isn't long until the sleaziest of all the collectors, Sterling, played by Mark Baloney, slithers onto the stage to make it known to one and all that he will be the one to have these stamps. Rebeck builds tension from the very first into the second acts, and the action directed by Harold Gervais is absolutely terrific. The play had a very short run on Broadway back in 2007. It was actually Bobby Cannavale, F. Murray Abraham, and Allison Pill, along with Dylan Baker, who played some of the roles. A word of warning, lots of dirty language in this one. It's not what I would call clean family fun. And the characters are fairly unredeemable, too. I would say that Mauritius rhymes with vicious, and there's a reason for that. All right, closing weekend coming up. What do you say to a shadow? Those of you who have been to the Shadow Box know they have chivalry on, but if you go earlier in the evening instead of going on at 9 o'clock, at 7 o'clock, Michael Alan Zell is a short story writer. He's transformed one of his short stories into a one-act play, What Do You Say to a Shadow? Directed by Angela Jo Strom. It's full of very clever writing. The cast of characters are two. Mary Pauley plays a very mysterious lady who comes in at the end of the day, and the shop owner, Richard Mayer, is the bookseller, and again, he's giving every indication he'd like this lady to leave his store. Anyway, it's Zell's first stage production. I must say I was pleasantly surprised by the interchange that they have between the two characters. Very sweet and innocent is Mary Pauley's character, and then she becomes very menacing. So it moves around, very interesting play. Those of you who want to see it, it'll be on for the remainder of the weekend, and then, of course, Chivalry follows it. If you go to that play, you get a $2 discount at Chivalry. At Loyola University, I want to let everybody know about a very interesting play that's opening up at the Lower Depths Theater. Some of us will recall the horrible tale of Kimberly Bergalis. She was the first recorded case of clinical transmission of AIDS that was deliberately done. She was allegedly infected by her local dentist here in New Orleans. And the family of Bergalis has commissioned for this work to be presented by Loyola University. It's directed by C. Patrick Jandusa. The third character in the play, besides Kelly and the dentist, is representing all of the untold number of sexual partners that the dentist had. And I recommend that we try to see this as well. It's going to be on for the next couple of weeks at the Lower Depths Theater, and you can make your reservations if you need to. $12 general admission. I think it's going to be great. And not to take away your thunder, Brian, but we have some things coming on of classical interest. The Louisiana Philharmonic Orchestra is presenting the Romeo and Juliet, a dramatic symphony by Hector Berlioz, and Richard Strauss's Don Quixote with the featured cellist Asier Polo. And that's going to be Saturday night. And we wanted to also remind everybody that there's going to be a very, very interesting ballet presentation. The Scottish Ballet is going to have the North American premiere of what ballet? A Streetcar Named Desire. And where else to have a ballet named A Streetcar Named Desire but right here in New Orleans? And that'll be next Friday, October the 4th. Hopefully those of you will have an opportunity to see that as well. I can't wait to see how they do the Stella, Stanley, and Blanche.
Yes.
Thank
you,
on toe.
Yes, exactly. On toe. Right. It'll be very interesting. And now it is time for our Artist Spotlight. Tonight we are featuring two pieces of historic pottery. The first is a lamp with a ceramic base of cat's claw design, and it's by Newcomb teacher and potter Joseph Meyer, very historic, and decorator Esther Eugene Elliott. And its shade with a magnolia design is by Elizabeth Golay Rogers Palfrey. The second is a kashpo with a stylized leaf design, and that's by potter Jonathan Brown and decorator Aurelia Coralie Arbo. Both are part of the exhibit Women, Art, and Social Change, the Newcomb Pottery Enterprise, featuring arts and crafts that women played a major role in creating, and which helped actually improve businesses and cultural communities that had struggled after the Civil War. It opens next Thursday, October 3rd, and will be on view at the Newcomb Art Gallery at Tulane University. And that's through March the 9th at 2014, that is. And visit newcombartgallery.tulane.edu for more information on that. Also art-related, looking ahead to Saturday, October 5th and Sunday, October 6th, the Creative Alliance of New Orleans is holding a home tour featuring art collections in the Central Business District. Go to cano-la.org for more information on that. And a reminder that you can check out Steppin Out's online calendar at WYES.org, including a screening on Monday evening at the Ashe Center of excerpts from the PBS documentary Latino Americans. And the evening will be hosted by, and he's been on our show, actor and writer Jose Torres Tama. New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen Julia Street has a question for us. Last time, Ruth Kesner gave us the names of two cruise lines that make trips across the Gulf of Mexico at different times of the year from New Orleans and the Mexican island that most visit. Actually, there are three. You've got either Carnival, Norwegian cruise lines, or the Royal Caribbean. The island, that's Cozumel. Now, tonight's question, in honor of the Saints playing Miami Monday night, one former Saints star posed in a bridal gown with then-coach Mike Ditka. The other briefly dated a Kardashian. Both were traded to Miami. Who are they? Send your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes: a Louisiana Life magazine subscription, a gift certificate for Vianne's Tea House, offering their culinary and gourmet tea experience for two. A new prize for the next few weeks: a copy of the book Statuesque New Orleans, all about some of our local statues. And that's by Ashley Merlin. And then tonight, we have WYES intern Jalon Singleton wearing an apron that says, "I shot the shallot, but I did not shoot the broccoli." A very famous reggae tune, right? Oh, yeah. From our friends at wearablevegetable.com. Now our picks. Poppy.
Looking for a copy of Louisiana Eats? Come see me signing tomorrow, 11:30 to 1 at Maple Street Bookshop. And then on Tuesday night, Dickie Brennan is hosting a rainforest-themed six-course dinner at Tableau. It'll raise funds for Dr. Mark Plotkin, who is doing conservation in the Amazon. And he's going to talk, Dr. Mark, about Creole ingredients that need to be conserved.
Oh, wow.
From the Amazon.
I know you love that
topic.
Who knew? Right. Brian.
Well, this year is the bicentennial of the birth of Richard Wagner, the great composer. Few people realize a lot of his antecedents for his operas are medieval. And so our own medieval group, Musica da Camera, is doing Minnesingers and Meistersingers, Wagner's inspiration, on September 29th at St. Joseph Abbey and October 6th at the Ursuline Shrine on State Street.
All right. They keep very busy. God love them, because thank goodness they keep the drive alive for that.
And that reminds me, I want to see more Wagner at the New Orleans Opera soon. We haven't had much lately. Monologues and Musings. That's Nell Nolan. She did it before. Now she's doing it again. It's called Monologues and Musings for Money, Honey. Two, and that'll be coming up Tuesday, October the 1st, and Wednesday, October the 2nd, at the Mid-City Theater. So hopefully everybody get a chance
and
to go there.
And that's a fundraiser for former Times-Speaking Union employees,
yeah,
I understand,
absolutely,
too.
Yeah.
And my picks, the Art Deco splendor of the New Orleans Lakefront Airport returns with a rededication this Saturday at 10 a.m. Don't forget to check that out. That's really beautiful. It's been a long time in coming. And Saturday night, the New Orleans Film Society Gala, Saturday night at the Ogden. And you can go to neworleansfilmsociety.org for details on that. And coming up on October 9th, I am honored to be included with some other media colleagues at the Childhood and Family Learning Foundation Gala. Go to childrenarewaiting.org for further information. And thank you all so much. Thanks for watching. Good night.